Warm greetings. Welcome to Wednesdays for Water. We are a citizens collective aiming to walk and talk water. We try to meet every week and connect people with various water worries and wisdoms. And in the process, we wish to curate future water warriors. The way we talk about trivial things for hours, water too needs walking and talking to address the rising water distresses. The way Wednesdays for Water is conceptualized as a prime time show, it wishes to make water everybody's business. The idea of the series was conceptualized in August 2020, and by the end of the year, the team and the structure was pretty much in shape. We started in April 2021 with Dr. Rajendra Singhji's inaugural speech. We wish to bring science and society together, and therefore we try to bring in every session either a policymaker or practitioner and a researcher academician. We also think that future generation is crucial, and therefore they have presence in each session. We are going stronger with every week now, with session on either quiz, couple of weeks of hard talks, and a week of soft session of art and music. There is a simple structure for each session of quiz, hard session and soft session, which are moderated by the core team member. Here is a glimpse of what we call as hard sessions and soft sessions. Besides walking and talking water worries and wisdoms collectively, we see this as a platform to cross-connect and expand our network and explore possible collaborations. We are also making notes to publish both scientific and non-scientific work. Here is a glimpse of some of our writings. You may reach us through email, LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and also look at our website www.w4w.in. We look forward to your suggestions and comments to make the series more meaningful and engaging. And meanwhile, we hope that you appreciate today's session.
During this conference and before that, we had some exposure trip to villages, and of course, I will also talk about some of my experience talking to youth and children from across the world in the course of my time, and what prompted me to work with the youth. So during this conference, when we visited some of the villages as part of exposure, we also took the urban youth, and there something we realize is, you know, the communities that that actually protected a lot of their natural resources for hundreds of years, like Orissa has an experience of community forest protection even before scientific forest management started in India, you know, from so kind of a lot of experience, but then the new generation, even in the villages, are not much interested in taking off this. And when you come to the urban areas, you know, you see that our youth have been, like I always keep on saying, because of my experience and exposure, that they have actually started to believe that water comes out of the taps and bottles. So that is a huge transformation that has happened between people of my generation who actually were very happily diving into a river, playing around with water, very, you know, without any hassles, without any fear per se. But then the current generation, which is getting more privileged, you know, having a bathroom, having showers and all, but then that also comes with another danger, that their relationship with water is actually somewhere, you know, that's getting disconnected. So that is something we realized. We had a lot of interaction with youths during this river conference. So they themselves realized after all this discussion that there is a need to actually work on this, because you know, the kind of water present and water future that we have given them, like for all of us. I find we are a credit card generation. You see, we are already choking up the water resource of our grandchildren. So we have overused what we have. So we have already we are using the future generation's water. So we are also sort of living we are also living a heritage that is not a good heritage, that is not a good thing that we are doing. We are already exhausting the current generation youth's future water availability as well. Their water future is also in jeopardy. So kind of all this prompted us to work with the youth. So during the last 2 years, what we have tried is we are trying to connect with as many as youth as possible. So as I was talking to Ganesh the other day, normally there are a few perceptions that exist at the moment, and there are certain misunderstandings about, I would say not misunderstanding, that would be a wrong word, but then the scope of understanding water is getting limited, and normally ask an urban youth and why he or she visits a river basically for picnic or during the winter. So they are hardly bothered about the water quality. There are a few movements across India, there are a few initiatives that are actually trying definitely to actually get youth involved. There are certain technical education going on, but overall my experience is nobody is interested beyond the beauty of a river during the picnic season or the beauty of a forest. So understanding the biodiversity value, for example, of a river, understanding the connections between monsoon and river and groundwater, for example, then understanding the role of watersheds in the remote areas in providing water to the cities, for example. So youth stay everywhere in India. So there are different kinds of youth. There are people who haven't seen a college. There are youth who haven't seen a school. They are working in the MGNREGS sites to actually restore your water bodies. There are also youth working in Chennai, for example, who had been forced to work from home because there was no water in Chennai. So you have these kind of different horizons that the youth are exposed. So that is something now we have to work out. That's something that I feel each network should work out, how all of them in their own respective areas with their own respective knowledge systems as actually work towards water conservation, work towards water security for the generations to come, for themselves as well as the generations to come. For example, we had been to a village called Bhagirathipur in Simlipal. Today, in fact, ironically, there's something is happening which we must all, I think I must discuss, is that aftermath of this cyclone, after the cyclone moved, one district where they were not expecting kind of impact is now being powered with a lot of rainfall. So Simlipal Bioreserve, I think the largest bioreserve in Asia, which was a few months back in the news for forest fires, is today receiving almost like 150 to 165 millimeter rainfall. And that is something that we kept on telling, is that rainfall is also impacting the downstreams, because rains in Simlipal actually impact the Budha Balanga River, and that river supplies water to a lot of towns and villages downstream. So that is a linkage the whole world is now thinking of working. So if a disaster happens, if an extreme precipitation event happens, if there is no forest in Simlipal, for example, then that impact will go downstream to the cities hundreds of kilometers downstream. Similarly, what is happening in the Nile Basin, what is happening in California now, everywhere you see, the interlinkages of, for example, wildfires, constant drought, what happened in Cape Town. So kind of starting from, your micro level, microscopic geographies to actually the larger macro, sort of interstate, intra inter country or transnational context, water has to be understood, and the youth have to understood, because we are the youngest nation now. The whole world is actually getting younger, and India is the youngest nation. So, and the decision makers are very soon going to be these people, these young people. So they have to understand, I would say, the interconnection between water, and they have to understand from each other. Because, for example, something that we are trying to do through these exposure visits, I don't claim success as yet. It's a very small scale effort. Is that, for example, a youth in Bhagirathipur understands that the feces that he finds or she finds in the river are actually an indicator of the health of the ecosystem, because he considers, or she considers, the river as a friend, a family member, and the source of happiness. But when you come down to the district headquarter, for example, a youth has never visited the river. Like, there are youths who never visited a river. So just leave aside their knowledge on the diversity of that the river supports, or in return get supported by. So these are the two kind of, you know, worlds that the youth also exist in India, or there are many layers of the world. So what I would suggest, and what I have been trying to do, is trying to develop an interlinkage. Like, there are several initiatives that we could take. We, as I was talking to Ganesh or Bibhu the other day, we actually need to team up. There are even between us, like people like us, I would say, would not be as techno, savvy, or very much effective in using technology. But then the new generation are actually very much into that, and they could help our experience, the new knowledge, the old knowledge, the wisdom, and the experiences and the technology. I think everything needs to be teamed up at this moment. So this is something the youth need from us, and everybody that who wants to work on water, who wants to work on climate change, because we are seriously in a country which lacks a lot of which already is rippled with a lot of problems, and our water crisis level, we are already one of the most water stressed nations in the world. So our climate change indicators are actually too scary, and we already have a lot of challenges. But then the problem is our combined efforts are actually missing very much. We have a lot of people working everywhere, but we really don't have a lot of networks that are connecting to each other, that are actually connected, that are actually trying to look into things in perspective. There are several
become mute.
It's okay.
We can't hear you actually.
No, somebody muted me. I don't know. So yeah. It's okay. So I think we have come to a time which is a climate emergency scenario, and there are definitely examples of Greta Thunberg and other. These are Ranjana or people like them. But then we have climate champions in each village in India. We have people who have restored water bodies, who have restored forests, but then the linkages are not known. And then the other, I think the next thing that I want to talk here is the kind of activism that we see across India. For example, I'm very much happy talking about the third world war for water. Like many speakers I have listened during the last 20-25 years, will be talking a lot about how the third world war will happen for water. But then the same people if you want to bring to their attention that the water body next to their door is actually being dumped with toxic materials, they would not come out of their homes because of several reasons. Because we are still not able to make our government institutions accountable. We are still not having a proper monitoring mechanisms, not for the rivers. Most of our river pollution data is actually manipulated. I have myself exposed that. So you just cannot help it. So there is no accountability. There is no independent accountability mechanisms. We have no independent educational institutes who could actually dare to provide you proper information. For example, India is yet to talk about the plastic pollution in its water bodies. So something that we should have already done 10 years before, our standards are not bringing them in. So we are still using the old standards. We are still thinking that we are 30, 40 years back. So I think there are a lot of works which the new generation could actually bring in. And something that I have been telling them is, you just start working. You just start bringing in the new thoughts, new technology. There is one way is actually to, for example, there is a report which might not be related, which is related anyway. So to revive the global biodiversity, for example, a report says that you need $700 billion. So, but more than half of it is actually by just readjusting your global finances. So similarly, similarly in water, you have to find out new solutions. Say water harvesting. So everybody is actually so much gaga about rooftop water harvesting, for example. But then in the same cities, the traditional water harvesting buddies are being actually killed. They're being destroyed. And you cannot be water sufficient in such a vast nation by just rooftop water harvesting. You have a lot of traditional water bodies across the nation, and they have been traditionally built looking into the geo ecological conditions suitably by our forefathers, very technically sound, and they carry a lot of traditional wisdom as well. So I think there is a need to do both. So reviving as well as bringing in new ideas. So somehow we are slipping off that revival part. We are just talking. We are talking. We are making very good talks. Even our government has started a new campaign. That's a very good thing, that we were talking almost 25 years back. Catch water where it falls. That's a very good slogan. But then there is no decentralization of water resources management. We are all for centralized systems. So I think that is where also youth should work. So in my opinion, youth should work directly to revive. You should work for the community, with the communities. They should work to bring in new technology, new thoughts. They should also work to bring in accountability and new systems of governance. So I think if we can actually work on all these as a team, then we can actually find a lot of solutions to the current water woes that we face, and the future as well. So I think I'll just rest my talk here, and happy to be responding to any questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ranjan ji. I hope Shivam, you made some notes of these things. I would be coming back to you to ask these questions once all the speakers have spoken.
Sure, sure.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Ranjan ji. And I think you have given the direction on where the youth should be working on, and giving your own example in various this work that you have done, and when you started, and the interlinkages of how climate, rainfall, reviving rivers. Amazing knowledge here. Thank you so much. I hope we really look into the action part, as you said. So now I request Dr. Ruchi to actually, I would first want to introduce Dr. Ruchi. Once Bibu told me about Dr. Ruchi, first thing I found her was on Wikipedia. So I would actually like to share a bit about what I found in Wikipedia. Of course, she's a great scientist in this field in the Wildlife Institute of India at Dehradun, and she's a professor there. She focuses on eco-development planning and participatory management. She's been doing amazing work in Pravasi Ganga Prahari, where it is a platform for both citizens of our country and others residing across the globe to contribute towards this Ganga cleanliness and rejuvenation under national mission of Clean Ganga Vision. So I would now request Dr. Ruchi, her own experience from her youth days to actually been in this field, what she learned, and how the current youth can learn from her experience and directly apply. And a bit about the Ganga Prahari thing, some case studies or examples of people whom people can actually take as kind of a role model, or some examples to replicate, how we can replicate some of these examples across the country. So over to you, Dr. Ruchi. Thanks again for joining today.
Thank you very much, Ganesh. Thank you very much. And you know, Mr. Panda has just set the stage. He's sort of talked of a large number of interconnectedness of water with climate change, with geopolitics, with activism and all. What I will try to do now is I'll just give you a small example of my own experience of working with the youth in the Ganga for reviving the Ganga River. And some of it actually, you know, I can answer some of the questions and issues that he has raised. And then probably during the discussion, I can put in more about my own experiences of working, because I work with a lot of youth, basically. So I'll just share a presentation. I hope I can do it. Can you see it?
Please.
Is it visible?
It's just still. Yes, it is. It is now.
Okay. So I will basically, as you talked about the Ganga Prahris, so you said Pravasi Ganga Prahri is just a small part of this initiative. So as you rightly said, I've been working on the Ganga River for the past 4 years, and I'm actually spearheading a project which is on biodiversity conservation of Ganga River, and now its entire, in its entire basin, and now for the other 6 major rivers of the country as well. So apart from the ecological dimension, one of the most important, dimension, and I should say it was a change in vision of the government, because it's a government project which has been funded by the Ministry of Jal Shakti through its mission on Clean Ganga, National Mission on Clean Ganga. So it actually indicated a change in the thought process of the governance, that for the first time, they thought that one of the key component of conserving the rivers is, there were two, in fact, two breakthroughs that we got this time. There were two, that if we want to conserve a river, we will have to view it as an ecological system and also take care of the biodiversity which lives there. It was the first. And the second first was that the communities who live along the Ganga, along with the other key stakeholders, need to be given an important and a need to be given a role, and they are a part of the whole process of conservation of these rivers. So as a part of that thought process, my institute and myself, we were given this big project. A phase one for the main stem Ganga ended in 2020, and phase two for the entire country was initiated in 2021 January. And during March, we've also initiated a large project for the other rivers of the country. So I will just now focus on the participation part and only on the youth part briefly, and the COVID part. So basically, I've already introduced you this whole thing, and our project extends to the entire Ganga Basin now. And basically, the idea is to involve multiple stakeholders, which involve local communities, on the principles of Jan Bhagidari to derive replicable models of conservation. So Mr. Panda rightly pointed out, that Orissa has been a place historically where there has been a lot of community initiative in conservation of forest, rejuvenation of forest. In case of Ganga, you know, it is a very different kind of a story. It has a lot of historical, religious and cultural importance, but not many efforts which directly go, and not many practices which actually go into conserving the river have been documented here. So basically, as a part of this process, we established a cadre of Ganga Praharis or guardians of the Ganga, which when we went into the community, we realized that there is a lot of youth particularly who do not have a lot of direction in terms of their life, career, education, and they want to do something for the society. They want to find a meaning. They want to find their own identity. We were also lost initially. We didn't know how to get this community participation. But when we started working with the people, and not only with the youth, with all sections of the community, the young, the old, the women, the men, the rich, the poor, the professionals, the unemployed, everybody, we realized that we could do a lot for the Ganga River and its conservation. And we also realized that this is something which the government cannot do alone. Everybody realized it. But it needs every hand on board. Basically, that was the idea. And that is how we could do it. And as the previous speaker said, that there is no direction to these efforts. What we realized, that we also realized the same. And we thought that we could actually provide a direction. And then we established this cadre of motivated volunteers from the community known as Ganga. And it's on the website. You can actually go to NMCG website and find all details about this interactive website. The other hallmark of this program was to train them and expose them. So we would train them on various aspects of biodiversity conservation, livelihood, community interactions, and now for COVID awareness, COVID relief, and so on. And I'll just show you now what all they are doing. And this training, actually, the kind of empowerment that happened. And the other thing was to provide them platforms. If anything happened in Dehradun, Lucknow, Patna, anywhere, we always said that please interact with our Ganga Praharis, call them. Interact with them, they will tell the solution. And so it was like for them a new world and a platform. And they realized that, you know, people are listening to them and they are powerful enough to talk to the CM, to the PM, to the minister, to the officer. And that was a huge process of empowerment and change. So it is a highly trained and motivated cadre of volunteers from the local community, in which by default, youth is the majority. And this is their location along the Ganga River. And now we've started establishing this border along the communities also. So basically, focusing on the pandemic, we realized that this pandemic and its economic and social impacts have totally disrupted all the dimensions of life and created a lot of issues for the people. And daily life of the communities along the Ganga, including the loss of livelihoods, health, mental health, became an issue. And for the youth, and especially for the vulnerable youth, you know, COVID actually posed a huge risk in terms of education, employment, and income, and so on. And therefore, we realized that these Ganga Praharis, most of them, in fact, majority of them are below the age of 40. It's a huge force, but it can be a disruptive force, and it can be a huge positive force as well. So when we did a fact check with the Ganga Praharis, after the pandemic last year and this year, we found that they started losing their motivation. Then women were very, very pessimistic. Lot of physical and mental health issues were coming up, but majority did not ask for help because they did not know where to ask for help. You know? And then there were a lot of impacts which everybody knows, which were, you know, common to others as well. And so our response was to start having regular online interactions with our Ganga Praharis. We are constantly in touch with them one-on-one. But right now, last year also during the pandemic and right now also, we cannot be together. So what we do is we've trained them on these online platforms. And so there are a lot of online interactions. We actually bring the experts to resolve their healthcare issues online. We engage them in skill enhancement activities, awareness programs, and also engage them in sensitizing the local communities. And of course, you know, I was seeing a video this morning that how the livelihood, challenges have brought new opportunities also. So that is also where we tried to engage them. And also, tried to give them a lot of motivational talks. And with the, you know, there is another cadre which is known as Ganga Prahari Mentors, where people like you and me are there. You know, anybody, any professional can become a Ganga Prahari Mentor, not necessarily a professional, but, you know, people who live along the Ganga are Ganga Praharis. or other rivers, then any citizen of the country can become a Ganga Prahari mentor. Any overseas citizen can become a Pravasi Ganga Prahari. And then we have the schools engaged with us known as Bal Ganga Praharis. So the Ganga Prahari mentors contributed, for a COVID relief fund, which was used for distribution of food particularly to the communities. Not Ganga Praharis normally managed, but some of whom who were really poor, who were helping the immigrant laborers last year. They were helped with this kind of food. And then they started working on a lot of, and you can see a lot of linkages are there for the Ganga Prahari mentor program also. And again, a lot of trainings on health, wellness, professional trainings, etc. were held. And this is the last training that we held for them on creating wellness using their own resources at home. And again, we needed last year after the COVID, and during the COVID, there was a lockdown and everybody wanted to study this impact of lockdown on the river health, on the water quality. And we trained these people online. And they were able to give these water samples where we could not reach, because we could not, our researchers could not go into the field. But they could collect this water sample and send it to the institute by road. And it reached in perfect condition for scientific analysis of these samples. And, there was 23 people were trained. 4 are now actively engaged in testing of water, water testing with various organizations. So this training provided them with a livelihood base, for them. And this is the locations from where the water samples were collected and sent to the Wildlife Institute of India without us going anywhere. Then preparation of People's Biodiversity Register in Bihar, that is what they are engaged in, and these Ganga Praharis have been hired by the Biodiversity Board in assisting, and there were 66 Ganga Praharis who are actually preparing this People's Biodiversity Register, particularly for the state of Bihar. Apart from that, we got professional doctors to actually engage them and train them in how they can actually, provide awareness to the people around them through online platforms, through, without any, with upholding the social distancing norms, to actually create awareness among this community. So this was another very important part. The other important part was also to spread awareness to the school children. So we created a lot of material in terms of posters, etc. And our Ganga Praharis actually became the, the ambassadors to take this message to remotest part of the country in these schools and for these school children, where they were actually telling them about these COVID awareness campaigns, etc. and the norms to follow. And then the most important part was, the emergence of a social leadership in these areas. We did, as I said, most of them did not ask for any help. It was when we approached them, then they actually told us, yes, we could help. We could actually use this. We could use some food packets. And they actually did a beautiful work along with the community in terms of awareness, food distribution. We had trained some of them in stitching, etc. So in these stitching center, the women started stitching masks and distributing them. They were actually coordinating with it because they became local leaders in their community. And so even the district administration is actually using them and engaging with them. Then gloves distribution, making sanitizer on their own and, distributing them. Helping people to install the Arogya Setu app, etc. And they were able to approach a large number of stakeholders. So these are the kind of activities which they were actually engaged in. Some of the school students, college students who are our Ganga Praharis created movies in local languages, small films, small short films on COVID awareness and spread it. Now, this is another PhD student who made very low cost hand sanitizer, and actually this was being distributed everywhere. Now, actually, we are trying to, the Ganga Praharis are being engaged by district administration, by NMCG to spread a massive awareness to not to, put the dead bodies into the river. And other very important function which was performed by this group of youth was taking care of the wildlife during the pandemic times when nobody could reach those areas, the aquatic life. And these are the kind of rescue activities which were carried out by them along and by informing the forest department. They are the first responders actually. And they've all been trained in handling these species. where they should be reporting in the legal aspects of it. So they are the first ones, and immediately they are all doing, you know, what a professional would do, and immediately reported to the Forest Department. And they have been recognized at all levels. They've been rewarded as Corona Warriors. Some of them have become Panchayati Raj Board members. Some of them have become Gram Pradhans and so on. And even now, when the, you know, Ganga Watch Committees are being, River Watch Committees are being set up, they are all members of this these committees. So what we realized that this initiative during the COVID time, it dawned upon us that we had created this cadre of people for biodiversity conservation and river conservation. But it was not limited to this task. It became a mass movement, which actually helped. It was like a drop of perfume in the society, which created a ripple effect. And most of the initiatives that they have taken during this time are self-sustaining, because they emerged from a very, very tough situation, and they have created their own solutions. And the youth has come to the forefront. Skill enhancement and capacity building have played a major role. And once they started seeing this initiative, a lot of other stakeholders have come forward, including NGOs, NCC, NSS, college students, Ganga Task Force, even the, you know, NMCG, etc. Another thing, aquatic species, when we could not reach there, and linkages developed for future possibilities for the future of these youth, and their confidence has risen like anything. You know, one of our Ganga Prairies even went on to meet the Prime Minister and informed him about the activities, you know, so they have no hesitation now. We feel a little hesitant, but they are not hesitant, because they have worked. They have worked on the ground, and they know that, you know, the Wildlife Institute of India is behind them. The National Mission of India is behind them. So they have all the support, but they are the ones who have worked and who are at the forefront. So I don't know why this is not going down now. So I have a last slide. So you can see that, you know, they are themselves creating these wall awareness programs everywhere, all along the river now, to ensure that, you know, the infected bodies are not released into the river. And the biggest part is they are part of the same society. It is not that they are people from outside preaching. They are part of the same society. So they, whatever they say, whatever example they set, will have a more far-reaching impact than, you know, what anybody else does. So thank you all, and then I'll answer more questions later.
Oh, this is amazing, Dr. Ruchi. I think after hearing you, I think we should have Kaveri Prahari as well. And I mean, I come from down south, and some of the experiments or things that you have done, I think if it is taken account today in some of these rivers, I think these are so replicable for all the rivers in the country. So I think this would have enlightened people listening to from different parts of the country today. And thank you so much again for taking time out for this talk. And I think Wikipedia article needs a lot of changes after I heard you today. Yeah. So now I would request the third speaker, Sunil Mysore. Sunil, you're here? You're not visible. So
I am here. Yeah, very much.
Yeah, so Sunil, you've heard the two speakers. So now I know we have to come back to some of the innovation on the rainwater harvesting. So I guess like you're perfectly fitting into that story. So before that, I would like to do some quick introduction about Sunil. I know this will be a short introduction because of the time constraint. Sunil is a founder and CEO of Hendrin Technologies, which is again in a climate action space, both in rainwater harvesting and solar energy generation. And Sunil Pai himself is a green champion. And I should also give a personal part as well. When I started my career in sustainability, Sunil was on who guided me, mentored me. And if I'm in this field, a lot should go to Sunil. So the first person I wanted to nominate from my side was Sunil. So Sunil, I know I've not done enough justice to your work that you've done all this while. So I'll leave it to you to share a bit about how you entered into this field of water conservation, water harvesting, clean tech, or rather the whole sustainability space. And what is that you would like to communicate to the youngsters, and taking parallels from what you have done and what you think could be done more? And also try to make a connection with how, I mean, like you're a Gandhian yourself, be the change you want to see that you always tell, right? How would you bring that about in the youth today? So over to you, Sunil. Thanks again for joining today. That's one more thing.
Yeah, it's my pleasure. Thank you. Thank you very much, Ganesh. So thank you for previous speakers actually give a lot of light into the water space. So I will just try to briefly talk about my journey in the water space and, you know, whatever little I have done and what I think could be done. See, the entire thing started from my engineering days, or even before that. You know, I used to do a lot of campaign for to stop using plastics or reduce plastics and so on. That was from when I was 15. So then I got into engineering. Very luckily, I got into civil engineering, where I got to study a lot of things about water, about hydrology, and everything, a lot of technical stuff about water. So, and then while I was in my engineering studies, I somehow picked up this entire thing about the environmental activism. So I used to be part of a lot of groups, a lot of initiatives, where I used to do some work, you know, in terms of mostly activism, nothing really on the ground, but, you know, it's something like kind of raise your voice kind of a campaign for, like, you know, stop water leakage and, you know, stop pollution and things like that. But after I finished my engineering and 2-3 years after I started working in some corporate companies, I got to realize that, you know, I'm doing a lot of talking, you know, a lot of activism and a lot of things like some shouting kind of a stuff, like nothing really happening on the ground. So then I was lucky to find some mentors who are actually working in the watershed management and who are actually doing some work on the ground. Perhaps a little academic, but, you know, I got in touch with them and I had a good opportunity to work with those people. You must have heard of Mr. Vishwanath. I had the opportunity to work with him and learn a lot of things about water, rainwater harvesting. And then an idea came to me that, you know, all these things must be actually taken to and you know, put into a very sound engineering medium and delivered as a product. You know, that's how the entire idea of actually water conservation as a product came into my mind. So that's how when I developed, you know, how can I weave all the technologies and whatever little I know and make it into a solution and give people, okay, say you implement this as a solution to conserve X amount of water. That was the initiation in which I started working. So I tried to make it as simple as possible for people to understand and assimilate. It's that I'm still learning for that, as a matter of fact, but this has been, I've been doing this the last 12 years now. So how I started was, like, you know, there was a lot of jargon about rainwater harvesting, a lot of jargon about, you know, groundwater recharge. So I wanted to, like, you know, demystify all that, get it into as simple terms as possible and make people implement it. Some I do, where I thought there was some intervention required, but mostly I thought, okay, it can be very easily communicated to people where they can pick it up by themselves. Because I have done some workshops at different places where people have told me that, you know, it's actually very easy to do it by themselves. You don't really require a lot of engineering expertise to do any of this. So that's how actually I come from. That's what I'm actually even trying to do even now. But, you know, make it as simple as possible and take all the jargons out of all the literature. So my journey started, like, you know, implementing small remote harvesting projects for apartment communities, industries, households. And the moment I said there's a solution like this available and the solution like this can be implemented and this is what it's all about and this is what it's going to cost, it became a market by itself. I didn't really actually go and do a business. So the market just picked up and thankfully, and that actually gave me an impetus saying, okay, this can be a solution, like a business idea, a commercially sellable business. So that's, and so then all this branding started, social entrepreneurship, this, etc. But anyway, I'm not going to all those details, but my journey started by that. From activism, I wanted to move into space of implementing. The moment it came to implementing, I said, okay, how to implement? I said, okay, better to actually make it into a product or a service, which people can easily accept. So that's how I started this whole thing. And perhaps I was the first, I don't know, but I was the first person to actually do it in a very commercial, scalable model. So it was like, okay, you want a solution, I have got it. So that's how entire thing started. So then I started, the journey continued in which I did a lot of harvesting projects. Till today, I must have done, my count says about 137 crores of liters of water I have actually harvested so far in the Bangalore city. So then the next challenge was, okay, this was like how the previous speaker said, this is not a solution by itself. We need to actually go and look into the traditional wisdom in which how this water is conserved, how does the water come back into the soil, how to make use of this soil water in a very equitable manner. So my last few years of work has been mostly into groundwater and you know, and saying, okay, how does the water get into the ground, and how do you take the water out of the ground, and how do you actually distribute it in a very equitable way. So I have been trying to do some work in communication in terms of in actually doing some work on the ground and on how to actually regenerate the soil water and how to get the water back into the traditional water bodies and actually making new water bodies in a very small, simple way, like a small open well in the house, which can actually get regenerated. For example, during the time when I was growing up in the old Bangalore, we used to get water from the wells. Though it was a big task to actually draw that water, the embodied energy of that water was very low. The same house now, actually we get the water which is 130 kilometers away. But it is much more convenient. You open the tap, the water just comes. But the transition from the well water to the tap water has come at a convenience, perhaps at a cost, but at a very high embodied energy. Because now what we used to get from 30 feet down below, now we are getting 130 kilometers far away. So this has been a transition which I have been as a little example of actually seeing this huge transition. But I am now trying to work, you know, we have to get back to this, maintaining the same convenience. The convenience has to be exactly as it is, but your embodied energy and should be much, much lesser. So this is to put it in a little technical way, but the idea is to actually rejuvenate or perhaps make the water as decentralized as possible, so that the cost and the embodied energy of the water is as minimum as possible. So this has been what I have been working. In parallel, since I have come into contact with a lot of people and you know, I've been doing some work in terms of water per se, and my personal interest is actually not only water, it is decentralization. So the space where I am sitting here, we grow our own food, we harvest the water, the energy water you see is completely solar. So my broader interest is actually decentralization, where the embodied energy of whatever we consume is as minimum as possible. So my other space where actually I'm trying to actually talk to many people and learning and teaching in the process is, how do we become more efficiently? If you actually look at this water, rainwater, it looks simple, like, you know, we are talking about 135 liters of water per person per day. But actually the challenge, in my opinion, is far, far bigger than what we are actually thinking it is. For example, our water footprint for Bangalore, or sorry, for an individual, is close to almost about 1800. I don't know, I may be wrong, but it is our water footprint is 1600 kg, sorry. It is to be 1600 liters of water per person per day. Our net water consumption, food, fuel, paper, all put together, our water footprint per person per day in India is 1600. Okay, so we will have to work very seriously on getting this number down. What we are actually talking mostly in the academic space is at 135, but not domestic water consumption. But we consume water much, much, much higher than that 135. Okay, there's a lot of embodied water in our food, in our energy, in the fuel, a lot of other things. So my work, or rather what I'm trying to work with many other people and partners is, like, you know, how do we get more efficient in terms of water space? Rainwater harvesting, traditional water, they're all on the demand side management. Sorry, supply side management. There is a very big space in the demand side management. Okay, where we get the water footprint per person as low as possible. I don't really have a number, what is an equitable number, but I feel our agricultural use, our industrial use of water is far, far higher than what we are actually entitled for. Either for what our available resources are there for. So I am not going to talk about equity because we don't have time now. I am only limiting my talk to the technical aspects of it. So where do I see people get involved in this? I talk to a lot of people who actually come. Some people ask for work, some people ask for, like, what can I do? But I have seen a lot of people who come and ask, tell me, I want to work on water. The problem is they have no idea. They just come and say, okay, they're not energy. They say, I want to work on water, I want to work on environment. But the thing is, defining their work and defining what exactly they can do and what is their tangible result, what they're getting out of the work is a very difficult task. And that is where I am trying to do whatever little I can. But I see a huge space for people who want to work on water efficiency. The next generation engineers can have a huge rewarding career in making water more efficient, you know, getting the water footprint low in production of perhaps this mouse or the computer or the communication what they're having now, there is a huge space. And given the cost of water, what we know is actually not the true cost of water. Okay, most water bills say 7 rupees, 10 rupees, 50 rupees. But actually the cost of water which the government incurs, the city of Bangalore where they come from, is almost close to 30 rupees per kiloliter. And they are selling that at 7 rupees. So in another decade or so, this is going to match the market price. At that time, the water is going to be very expensive. So by that time, if you have got good set of people who are ready to actually make things more efficient, make stuff which is like less water dependent, there's going to be a huge market, going to be a huge career for people who want to work in the water efficiency spaces in terms of the demand side management. In the supply side, we can do a lot of things. For example, reviving the traditional water bodies. And as the previous speaker said, we must get that old wisdom. There's a lot of technology in that. It's somehow missing. And all our technical knowledge is actually not addressing that. So we are not able to get what these guys did to actually be water secure. They are only talking that in documentaries, but we don't have a good technical paper saying, okay, this is what is being done. This is what we can do. And if we do this, we are going to get so much water. So mostly a lot of things are happening in the academic space. We need that academic space to trickle down to actually field work. And people actually have to get on the ground to implement this. I know a lot of people who want to take up activism. Good, there's no problem in that. But we need as many number of people to actually work on the ground, actually implement things, get their hands dirty, use sound engineering principles and actually get to the bottom of the problem and try to do as much as they can in terms of one on the supply side and other on the demand side. So there's a huge opportunity. Really, people want to work on this. We can do a lot of things. We can have a huge, we can have one session only on the next gen requirements. That is possible. Because of paucity of time, I am just ending it here. This is briefly my thoughts on the subject. If there's any question, whatever little I know, I'm very happy to share.
Thank you so much, Sunil. So one thing is I've been blessed to listen to you whenever I want. So I'm glad that the audience could listen to you today. And also, thanks for bringing off the component on the cost of water. So that is something that people should start realizing, and the embedded energy component as well into the talk. So without taking much time, I would now request Shivam, who's the national coordinator for youth engagement at Climate Reality Project, who himself is an entrepreneur trying to work with students to solve problems in water and climate action, to take over now and ask the questions that he has actually made from all this discussion. And meanwhile, I request all the audience to write down your questions, which also Shivam would read out after he asks the questions that he has in mind. And please type your questions so that we can take those questions. One humble request to all the speakers and everybody out there is, I think the discussion is going really good. We may want to extend it by another 20 to 20 minutes more. Request for you to stay for another 20 more minutes so that we take the best advantage of the question and answer session. Okay, over to you, Shivam.
Yeah, thank you so much, Ganesh, and amazing session. And I just have a few questions. I'll try to go one by one in the same sequence how the speakers have spoken. So I'll start with Ranjan, sir. So, sir, you talked about your experience in Odisha. I just had one question regarding the replicability of solutions. I mean, I have visited this village called Hivre Bazar, which is near Ahmednagar. So they have done some tremendous work in rainwater harvesting and other, rural-based solutions. But a village which is just 1 kilometer away from that, they don't have it. So my question is, maybe a solution which is viable in Odisha may not be applicable to UP or Gujarat or Rajasthan. But still, we can take some lessons. So what do you think that is, what resistance is there, which is halting the replicable, the same solution which can be easily applicable into this another context, another village, another area, but it's not happening. So what do you feel that that trigger factor or what that resistant point is? So if you can just explain on that, that would be great.
Yeah, thank you so much. I think you have raised a very valid point. That is something we have been actually struggling with, ever since we started working. On replicability, the problem exactly is when we think that everything can be replicated elsewhere. So that we should first begin with that idea that no, it is not possible to be replicated. And as you said rightly, each village is a different geoecological, geomorphological setup, and each area has its own history of rainfall and temperature, and its own soil types, its own kind of watershed contours and all. So when we talk about replicability, I think we should look into a few core principles of what exactly should be, the sort of the framework in which we should work on replicability rather than replicating the effort itself. And that is where you need first is the need of that village. Then the second thing is the kind of collective effort that you can actually put in, what kind of effort you need to put with the villagers. Third is what kind of traditional knowledge actually that exists in that particular village. And fourth is what kind of modern technology and other initiatives that you can actually bring in to fulfill that particular wants or needs whatever that village has. So then fifth, of course, is the kind of finance and other support system that you can generate. So if your framework of the approach that you take on an effort, if actually you take all these five, there are more, but I think just quickly I'm recalling that this could be the five things. So any effort that has actually got a potential to be accepted by the community because it meets their need, and it has also the potential to engage them through their own knowledge and participation, and also the potential to be actually replication also gets impacted by finance and other support systems. So government to government, actually the approach differs. So you have to have all these five things together to see that a particular effort in principle is replicated, but an effort cannot be replicated as it is. So we within Odisha also, like for example, we have these kind of structures that are called, for example, in the entire Central Highlands, you will find the kind of a talab culture, the sagars. They are huge water bodies with three side open that will catch the water from the catchments, all the catchments, and one side close. So that is not found in the coastal Odisha, because the geography is completely different. They only have small water bodies, and their water availability in many parts is at a shallow level. So they have a complete different kind of structures. So even if you have two drought prone areas, for example, in Maharashtra or in Rajasthan or in Odisha, three drought prone areas, these three areas will have three different solutions. So I think understanding that geography, also many water harvesting structures, for example, in Manerga, MNREGA, they fail because they don't take into account the kind of the place, the geography actually where they locate the structures, because they just dig ponds. So I think the traditional wisdom which I was telling, and the last speaker was also telling, I think Sunil, is something that actually guides us in that, because they understand where exactly you actually should dig a particular kind of structure. And some of the modern technologies are helping. Like I am aware of a particular website I'm just forgetting the name, but there is an organization called the Foundation for Ecological Security, and they have devised a particular app which actually makes you, which gives you, you know, the locations, exact kind of soil type, the ground water situation. So you understand that whether a particular kind of structure will hold water here or not. If at all it will hold, then for how long? So at the end, we must understand that there are two important factors that work in success of our work. First, as I said, the ownership of the community, as I think the resource person from was talking from WIAC was also telling, and everybody else understands that. So, and ownership comes only when the initiative is viable and sustainable. Otherwise, it will just be another work where you engage people as a labor, and they just then you know go away. So I think replicability should look into this. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir, for that beautiful answer. So now my next question will be to Dr. Ruchi. So before that, ma'am, I would like to share my experience. So me and my friends, we started small sessions with Fauzia ma'am and Dr. Karnal Dalvi regarding rainwater harvesting. So we were given certain tasks. So in that task, I decided to go back to my village, which is in eastern Uttar Pradesh. So I just did a small survey kind of thing. So we had 27 water bodies, like the ponds, tal, talaiya, tala, pokhara, and all that. So we had 27 and we were left with one. I mean, the current scenario was such that we had one. So I thought, I said that this should change. So my question is also something, in relation with the same context. When I tried reaching out to my community, I felt a barrier, which it may be of trust. I mean, are we trusting enough our youth? So I was like, I talked to some of my villagers out there. I said that you should revive this pond. Maybe I'll help you with my organization. I'll try to help you out. But I mean, they were not convinced. I don't know, something was happening. So I consulted with my grandfather, and he said that we'll call for a small, dawat or party kind of thing on some occasion. So in December, on 25th of December, we had it. And I took 10 minutes and explained them the concept that you should do a revival of water bodies. Pokhras and talabs are very much required. They are the natural water or rainwater harvesting system, the traditional one, which we call. So they were convinced. I mean, after that, when I had the first, when I had that joint dialogue, then I mean, they were convinced. But the problem is, I still face such issues at my end. Whenever I go to a community, people look at my age. While looking at your presentation, I saw most of the Ganga prairies, they belong to the young crowd, that, you know, the youth. So how do you tackle this solution? How do you tackle this problem? And what solution do you propose to, you know, when it comes to, you know, first, obviously, we can create leadership, but the community should also be in sync with that leadership role and should also comply, should also be receptive to the idea that a young person is leading that community. So, I mean, I would love to hear your opinion on that.
Yeah, okay, thank you very much, Shivam. And so, you know, what I would like to say, that what you faced, we faced exactly the same thing. And in fact, you were an insider, we were outsiders, and we were dealing with the five states and, you know, so many different communities, different economic, social, geophysical situations. But, you know, what it requires is a lot of social engineering, you know, what I would say that. So it is not as if you approach the youth only. You approach the village as a unit. You know, it is an interlinked unit. And then you talk to the old, you talk to the women. And the language is different for each group. You know, and you just don't go and talk there. Nobody listens. So we create these small opportunities. We create these small, like we keep on going back to these. And getting a breakthrough is difficult, the initial one. You know, if you've got a breakthrough in one village, then slowly you can go in the surrounding areas. But that first breakthrough is very difficult. A. Secondly, you know, the community will always look for something. What is there in it for us? Because many people come with such programs. You and me are not the only people. All the government programs, you know, when we started, we thought, oh, ye to bahut acha ho gaya hai. We are at the right time. And the NRLM is also there. So we will coordinate with the NRLM people and then we'll launch our program. And we went and talked to them. They said, please help us. I said, bhai, ye to bichare khud hi pareshan hai. Ye kaise karwa payenge? But, you know, in the end, they also realized and we also realized that we could build up these synergies and we did. And we did build up, but it was at a later stage when we could actually get into the community. So we established for the women, we established livelihood centers. For the youth, we started engaging them in livelihood activities again. And then we got some of them over for training, capacity building. We used a whole lot of platforms like, you know, wall paintings, Nukkad Natak, small exposure trips, training programs. We used our own team of young people, you know, who were scientists and talked science, and that made a lot of sense to them. And, you know, they could understand what they were trying to say. Then we talked to the old people, we talked to the pradhans and so on and so forth. Somewhere we succeeded, somewhere we did not. It takes time. But wherever we succeeded, we started working from there. And we started creating this online platform of Ganga Prairies. We actually worked from the bottom to the top. And there we actually, initially we made a, we did a All India workshop of 250 Ganga Prairies at Rishikesh, Paramarth Niketan. And I think that was a change when people saw that, okay, I'm not the only person and there are all these people from different areas coming and working for the river and, you know, they are people like me. It gave a whole lot of different flavor. And then when we want to talk to them, we don't go ourselves all the time. We take people like them. Now the Ganga Prairies of one, and they are all now connected. So Ganga Prairie of one state, rather than asking me, will actually go and ask his friend who might be in another state or another location or, you know, in say somebody from Varanasi will go and talk to somebody in, Kannauj or Farukabad or, Kanpur and so on and so forth. But what we try to do is we facilitate this exchange. We provide and constantly, slowly and gradually, we are trying to build this leadership in them because it is a social change. Conservation ethos is not something which we do as a task, as a one-time project. It is a change in behavior. It is a change in lifestyle. And change is not easy to come. It is not easy to bring about change. So we have to work from all dimensions and everybody has to work. I would say that it is like, you know, a vehicle driven by five tires. So it is not a single tire that will pull it, you know. Everything has to be functional. The government system, the NGOs, the awareness, you know, the human resource development, extremely important part. The social groups which are formed there. So we have worked with religious leaders. We have worked with the local, the local media. We have worked with the district level officers. We've worked with the police. We've worked with the army. So we've tried to work with all types of stakeholders. So we just cannot go into a village and create an intervention. We might, but as you realize, it is a lot of work. But for it to sustain, that sustainability of efforts also has to say that people have to see where it leads them. They have to be, so we have to have a combined vision with the community where we can show them, okay, this is what it will lead to and it can lead. So thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for that enlightening response. Mansi, ma'am, do you want to add something? I saw your hand raised.
You're on mute, Mansi.
Shivam, is my hand raised? I didn't realize it. I'm sorry. But I just, because I'm speaking now, I would like to thank all the speakers and Shivam, you, that you could make out time and you have some wonderful questions to ask everybody. Because it has been really desire that youth comes out and speaks what they think about it, because my generation is doing a lot of things, good or bad is secondary. But unfortunately, youth do not have so much voice both ways. The community is not taking them seriously and youth are also not making voice and noise, both, you know. So yeah, I'm just listening, I'm enjoying, you carry on.
Okay, so my next question is for Sunil sir. Sunil sir, when I completed my MBA from XLRI Jamshedpur in HR, and I was all set for a corporate job. But then I eventually, because I was part of climate reality since 2015, then I thought that I need to go into the field that is something where my passion lies. So I went into this domain of sustainability, of how I can bring youth and connect them with projects and bring that change. I'm very happy and satisfied with the response that I have received from all the, everyone from the society. But the moment I still remember the first day when I told my parents, my family that I want to do something, they literally went into coma. I mean, it's a huge risk. Plus, the type of thing that I was proposing was sustainability. They said, "Ki, do you want to start an NGO?" I said, "No, not an NGO, but something similar to that. I mean, I want to work for sustainability, irrespective of whatever type of organization that I build up. I mean, I started 3 years, 4 years back. I'm still exploring it. That what type of organization? That's a different story. But what do you think? People are not still trusting enough when it comes to the commercial startup based on sustainability. I want to do rainwater harvesting. I want to do solar. I want to do vertical gardening. Anything which is related to waste management, energy efficiency, biodiversity, or anything of that sort. Others, maybe if I tell them that I want to go ahead with and put 5 cabs, Uber cabs, they will be convinced. Okay, there will be some fixed income coming out of it. But when something about environment comes, they only think of, okay, this is activism, this is ped lagao, pani bachao, ped lagao, pani bachao, and all that. So what do you think that, what has to change? And do you think that Indian startup ecosystem has also not been supportive of startups specializing in sustainability? So my question will be, it's like a question come my own personal hardships that I have faced. So yeah, your opinion on that will be very valuable, sir.
I just want to add one more thing. When I left my job in General Electric and wanted to start something on sustainability, first question my mother asked was, who will marry you? So yeah.
See, it's like a very, very good point. Actually, I have been in the exact same situation as you are in. And actually, the same question was asked to me by my mother as what was asked to Ganesh by his mother. See, I belong to a very orthodox Brahmin family where, you know, getting a nice job, vade sambar, breakfast and, you know, settling is was the norm. But when I went and told, no, I want to do something different, because I come from a family where the norm was, okay, you do your engineering, go to US. That was the norm. And I was the first guy who said, okay, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to do something different. And you know, I there was a lot of problems, absolutely no doubt about it. And I got the same comments and I faced the same kind of situation as you are in. But I think this was like 13 years, 14 years, I think a lot of changes have happened. I meet regularly people, you know, who are ready to take this change. And you know, there's now almost the next generation. You know, I think now the parents, I think, are far more supportive. See, when you come to my generation, you know, there was like, you know, there was always a financial challenge. I think now, by and large, at least in the middle class families, that challenge has been taken care of, and they're ready. You know, they're okay with the children to experiment a little bit. But having said that, see, what needs to change? Okay. See, not all businesses will succeed. We have to understand this. Go to talk to any VC and you'll say, boss, I will invest in 10 companies. I am sure 9 companies are not going to do well. Okay. So we are not even talking about the VC range companies now. So what an entrepreneur or what a guy who wants to get into a business has to think really deep is like, you know, he has to compare himself with any startup. See, there's absolutely nothing that you gain as an incentive because you're working in the environment space. Your business model must be focused in such a way that, you know, you are doing a normal business. You compare it with the Kirana store, you compare it with the Paytm, you compare anything, but your business model has to be financially sustainable. Okay, if you want to do an NGO, if you're getting a grant fund, it's a different ballgame altogether. Okay, it depends on your influence, depends your what is the impact that you're going to show, and if somebody is going to give you money for that, well and good. But if you want to start a business in the environmental space, your business model must be like any other business model. Okay, there is nothing that you get as an advantage. Maybe you can brand yourself and, you know, for marketing purpose, you can say it is an environmentally driven company, sustainable. Sustainability is the norm, like, you know, how a mobile phone is a norm, sustainability has to become a norm. Okay, sustainability has to be your default choice. So your entire business model or the drive of doing a business must be actually make sustainability affordable, accessible and profitable. So when you are going and selling person a solar energy, you must convince first yourself that even it's viable. Then you must have the wherewithal, you must have the knowledge, you must have the skill, and you must have the communication capability to tell the person, boss, what I'm going to sell to you is good for the environment, good for you, financially sound, and definitely viable. See, if you come and try to talk to me and say, boss, put 1 lakh, it's going to give you a return of so much, I immediately start thinking about it. Okay, but you say you give 1 lakh and, you know, and if you give me a story of how it's going to help the environment, I will still think about it, but my response will be a little later. Or maybe I'll take some more time to actually make up my mind. But the entire thing, what I'm trying to tell you now is, now environment, whatever sustainable thing we are talking about is definitely economical. Okay, we can definitely have a good conversation when I can go into economics of every technology and actually go and actually prove that, you know, what we are trying to do is not economically bad. Okay, there is an environmental footprint and you put a small environmental cost, and most of the things what you are trying to tell or trying to do is makes economical sense. At a larger ball game, you know, like I've been doing this business for 12 years now. When I combine economics and environment, there is a very good reception. Like, you know, people do give me a hearing. Initially, when I started talking, it was very difficult, you know, for people to even give me time to listen. But now, when I make up a case, like, you know, or at least 7 out of 10 people give me a very patient hearing. Okay, and you know, try to make sense of what I'm trying to tell. Okay, because I am pretty sure that, you know, most of the technologies, what, see, why is there such a big demand for solar energy? Why did we see a boom in solar space? Okay, not because it's environmentally good. Okay, it was because it became cheaper than coal. Now discounts are actually running behind government saying that, you know, stop solar because they are making a loss. So what is actually environmentally more sustainable is economically more viable than the conventional sources. So, and the sustainability is becoming a default choice, you like it or no. In 10 years from now, it is going to be like that. Okay, so what me and you or everybody here trying to do is actually hasten this process, that's all. Okay, and I'm pretty sure it's going to happen. Energy in this space, what I see from, there are so many startups, commercial startups, NGOs, actually were coming. For a few days back, I happened to meet somebody who has started a skill development NGO only to train technicians to do electrical work for solar energy. It's a pretty decent idea. Like, you know, and he has got some small grant funding and he has started it up. So, I think the initial, you know, resistance what we are actually seeing, I think it's dying down actually, it's pretty soon. And post-COVID, mind you, it's going to be even better. Like, you know, people are talking about sustainability now. Urban farming has become a very big thing. You know, like eating healthy, you know, eating organic, all things, you know, the balance has come into the normal day-to-day conversation. I think post-pandemic sustainability will take even a better shape. I think it's going to, you know, exponentially increase the entire thing about sustainability, sustainable products, environment. I think there's already some talk. I think the Shell is coming up with a huge paper about net zero. Net zero may be very ambitious, but at least somebody's talking about it. Okay, so we can name, for example, a good business model is, you know, net zero home, net zero factory. Okay, and Ganesh is working on net zero discharge. So we can have this kind of models. I think it's going to be a pretty big game changer. I hope I answered your questions.
Yeah, very much, sir. Thank you so much for that. Ganesh, that will be it from my side. I mean,
Shivam, I would also like to give a task to you. If you find any questions in the conversation, would you ask on behalf of the participants if there is any? Or
I think we had some issue today have people on the chat box. I would like to apologize for that people did not have much access to the chat box except few, one or two people. So we don't have a question, but because of that, you may actually take one or two questions from the audience, because then it will be fair if it allows you. Okay.
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. I know we have exceeded by 23 minutes, folks, but still we would like to take any question. Please raise your hand. Would like to have you your question. In between, I should also tell please follow us on LinkedIn, Instagram, Facebook, and all channels, Wednesdays for Water. Please spread the word. Excellent work is done by Megha, Vasanta, and a lot of people are doing a great puja. A lot of people are putting a lot of work in the background. So request all of you to support this initiative. Any questions, anybody? Yeah, I think there are links being shared. Manasi sharing the links. Please subscribe to these, because we will be wanting you to join future sessions, and we are having various activities like Thursday quiz, facts on Wednesday, Mondays. So a lot of things are coming on all these events, and even our if you have missed any of the talks in the past, the YouTube links are available. That is also there in our social media, you can access. And if you felt this talk was really great, we would be sharing this video, and please tell your friends to see this video, and that way they would not miss the wisdom that they would have got in attending this session.
Yeah. May I also announce the next session, please, if it permits? Yeah. So because there are no questions from people, I would like to invite you for the next Wednesday, when we talk about water and agriculture. Again, we will have the same format. A youth will be there, and a scientist and an agriculturist. And we will talk about water and agriculture, followed by water and forestry. So we do have some sessions lined up. So please do join us. Thank you. Yeah, over to you, Ganesh.
So thanks again. I think I would also definitely mention the contribution by Manisha, Jagpreet, Pooja, Rajiv, and all in this process. They have been doing a lot of work. So please, looking forward to have you in the next Wednesday. And please reach out to us on wednesdays.for.water@gmail.com for any questions. And of course, you can always interact us through even the social media as well to get in touch with us. Thanks again. Wonderful evening. Looking forward to the next Wednesdays for Water. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, speakers, for the enlightening session. And thank you, participants, for joining and making the session interactive. Let me quickly take you through the individuals who make this collective. Vibhu Prasad Nayak, Faujia Tarannum, Ganesh Shankar, Rajiv Shah, Gautami Baviskar, Manisha Sharma, Megha Gupta, Srinivas MR, Vasanta Subeya, and myself, Mansi Bal Bhargav. We represent Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Hyderabad, Terry School of Advanced Studies, New Delhi, Environmental Design Consultants, Ahmedabad, FluxGen Sustainable Technologies, Bengaluru, CounterView, and we are supported by WIKI's Water Resources Council. We appreciate your support and encouragement in conducting the series, and we hope that you will stay connected with us and continue joining us. Thank you once again to all of you. We look forward to having you in the next session. Please take care of yourself. Bye-bye.